الحمد لله الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى أما بعد قال الله تعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إنا أعطيناك الكوثر فصل لربك وانحر إن شانئك هو الأبتر صدق الله العظيم سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما اللهم افتح علينا حكمتك وانشر علينا رحمتك يا ذا الجلال والإكرام يا رب صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم اللهم صل على محمد بعدد من صلى عليه اللهم صل على محمد بعدد من لم يصلي عليه اللهم صل على محمد وفهمني بأسرار القرآن الحمد لله. Today is our ninth session of doing the درس of the Holy Quran, and inshallah today we will be covering the shortest surah in the Holy Quran. The shortest surah in the Holy Quran consists of three sentences. Scholars have mentioned there are three surahs in the Quran which are the shortest surahs. One is Surah Al-Asr, which has three sentences. One is Surah Al-Nasr, which has three sentences. And one is Surah Al-Kauthar, which has three sentences. However, the shortest surah are these three, and from these three, the shortest surah from these three is Surah Al-Kawthar. So from the whole Quran, the shortest surah is Surah Al-Kawthar. The surah which comes before that is Surah Al-Asr, in terms of the second shortest surah. So Surah Al-Asr has approximately 14 words and 74 letters. 14 words and 74 letters. Whereas Surah Al-Kawthar has only 10 words and 43 letters. So half in terms of letters. So this is Surah Al-Kawthar, is the shortest surah in the Quran. However, it's the surah which scholars, when they've actually spoken about Surah Al-Kawthar and they've done commentary of the Quran, Surah Al-Kawthar, it's the most comprehensive surah in the whole Quran in terms of understanding the maqam, the status of Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This is why if you will listen to the scholars, mufassireen, who have done commentary on Surah Al-Kawthar, they have actually spent 4, 5, 6 hours just talking on the shortest surah in the Holy Quran, Surah Al-Kawthar. If you look in the commentary, in the Tafsir books, they have spent pages and pages, pages after pages, just explaining Surah Al-Kawthar. Why is it the most comprehensive surah in the Quran? Because it talks about the status of Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the maqam of Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know, there are two things, scholars mentioned, there are two things which a person can never achieve. He can write books after books, he can talk hours on end, but he will never be able to achieve two things. One is to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He will never be able to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his totality. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. If you were to count, forget shukr, if you were to just count the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَا تُحْصُوهَا, you will never be able to count the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let alone doing shukr on the blessings. So one of them is counting or doing shukr on the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one will never be able to achieve in its totality. And the other is to talk, is to explain the status of Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You can spend hours and hours, you can write books after books, but you will never be able to explain, you will never be able to describe the status of Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? Because we don't understand the maqam of Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then how can we ever explain his maqam without understanding his maqam in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This is why a poet has very beautifully said that ba'adiz khuda buzrug tuwi qissa mukhtasar. Lahu Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, meaning, how can we praise you? In short, we will say this, ba'adiz khuda buzrug tuwi, that after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the status is yours, qissa mukhtasar, full stop. How else can we praise you, O Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Ba'adiz khuda buzrug tuwi qissa mukhtasar. And this surah, talks about the status of Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam through not our tongue, but through the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why this surah is very comprehensive in terms of making someone understand the maqam of Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this is the surah which directly speaks regarding Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So scholars have mentioned there are only three surahs in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly talks to Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the whole surah is dedicated for Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The first surah is Surah Al-Duha. وَالْضُحَى وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى. When Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam first started receiving wahi, revelation, there was a gap, there was a pause. Some narration suggests 6 months. There was no wahi coming. Could you imagine? In anticipation, there was nothing coming. And scholars have mentioned that he had this feeling that maybe I've done something. That's why the wahi has stopped coming. Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upset with me? And then, when the first wahi came after this pause, was wadduha. The wadduha wal-layli idha saja ma wadda'aka rabbuka wa ma qala. That your Lord, your Allah is not upset with you. And He will not leave you alone. And the whole surah is talking about Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى وَوَجَدَكَ ضَالًا. And then, etc. And then the other surah which talks about solely regarding Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Surah Al-Inshirah. The surah after that. أَلَمْ نَشْرَحْ لَكَ صَدْرَكَ وَوَضَعْنَا عَنْكَ وِزْرَكَ الَّذِي أَنْقَضَ ظَهْرَكَ وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ. So these two surahs solely talks about Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and explains the maqam of Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then the third surah, which is exclusively for Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is this surah, Surah Kauthar. So inshallah, in today's session, we'll be going through Surah Kauthar. Now one thing I'd like to mention, because last week I was talking about shaitan and nafs, and I spoke briefly about shaitan and nafs, and I said last week that inshallah in today's session I will complete the shaitan and nafs session. But because this surah is so comprehensive and is going to take a little while, I thought of talking about shaitan and nafs, which we started talking last week, inshallah next week. So inshallah regarding shaitan and nafs, which I promised I'll talk today, inshallah I'll talk about that next week, so that I can just solely focus today on this surah, Surah Al-Kawthar. So before understanding any surah or any verse, and I've mentioned this in Surah Al-Feel as well and other times as well, a person has to understand the shani nuzul, the context of a surah. If a person was not, and who doesn't know the context, the background of a surah or of a verse, then he will never be able to understand fully what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to say in this verse or in this surah. This is why it's called shani nuzul. Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed a specific surah? Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed a specific verse? There was a background behind that. And because of that background, a verse was revealed. Because of a background, a surah was revealed. So question arises, what was the shani nuzul, the background of Surah Al-Kawthar? So regarding that, scholars have mentioned few things, so inshallah I will mention that. So Surah Al-Kawthar, one thing we need to bear in mind is to understand the background of this surah, there's something else which we need to understand. So one is the background of the surah, but even before the background of the surah, something which we need to understand, and that is the family of Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, at the age of 6, he lost his beloved mother. At the age of 8, he lost his his granddad. And then at the age of 25, he married Hazrat Khadijah al-Kubra radiyallahu ta'ala anha. From Hazrat Khadijah al-Kubra radiyallahu ta'ala anha, he had his first son, and that son was called Qasim. This is why Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would often be called Abu al-Qasim, the father of Qasim. So that's the first child. And then thereafter, he had four daughters: Zainab radiyallahu ta'ala anha, Ruqayya radiyallahu ta'ala anha, Umm Kulthum radiyallahu ta'ala anha, and Fatima radiyallahu ta'ala anha. And thereafter, he had another son called Abdullah. So four daughters, two sons from Hazrat Khadijah al-Kubra radiyallahu ta'ala anha. And then he had another son from Maria Qibtiyah. And that son was born in Madinat al-Munawwara, and that son was called Ibrahim. So this is a brief background regarding the family of Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he had his first child, and he named his first child Qasim. Okay? And you see, when a person has his first child, her first child, okay, this is the most important time of their life. Because they've just had their first child, the anticipation, the looking forward. Okay? Only a mother knows how much and how they anticipate, okay, having that first child. This is why I'll mention that after this. So only a mother knows the anticipation. So when Qasim was born, the first child, that child only lived for a couple of years. Some scholars have mentioned 2 years. Okay. But in infancy, he passed away. He died. And when a child dies at a very young age, okay, it is very painful. Especially for mothers. Very painful. This is why, you know, if you really want to understand how painful something is, then you need to understand, you need to know the reward. The greater the reward of any ibadah, of anything, that will show you how hard that pain was, or how hard that worship was. Do you understand that? The higher the reward, that means you're getting that reward which is so high. Why? Because that ibadah or that thing must have been really hard. That's why you're getting the most reward. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, okay, from all the reward which He has given, the reward which He has given to that mother and to that father who has lost a child is amazing, is meaning words can't describe. Why? Because the pain that mother and that father will have gone through when that child will have passed away. Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wasallam said in a hadith that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He gives the responsibility to angel Israel to take a child's soul, and he comes with that soul to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks the angel, that, "O angel, have you taken the soul of a person's child? Have you taken his son's or his daughter's soul?" So the angel says, "Yes, as you told me, I have done that." "Did you take the joy of his heart or the joy of her heart?" Meaning, when you took the soul, did you take the soul of the apple of his dad, or apple the apple of her mother? So the angel says, "Yes, O Allah, this is that soul which I've taken." Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the angel that when you extracted that soul, What did the mother say? Or what did the father say? And the angel says that at that time they were enduring patience. They said, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on their reply says that, O angel, for them, for that mother, for that father, I have built a house in Jannah. And that Jannah, that house in Jannah has got a special name, Baytul Hamd. That house has got a special name, Baytul Hamd. And that house is solely for that couple, for that mother and for that father. Scholars, they write something very beautiful. That when, because there's other narration where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said that if you do this, you will receive a house in Jannah. Scholars have mentioned that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He will build a house for you in Jannah, then that is in a way a guarantee that you will enter Jannah. Because why would He build a house in Jannah for you without you being there? You understand? Without you being there, the house is no use for you. So when He's built a house for you, that's an indication that you're going to live in that house. That's why He's built the house. That's an indication that inshallah you'll be entering Jannah. Another reward. Once, and often this person used to come in the presence of Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He used to come with his child and he used to sit in the majlis of Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And for a long time, he didn't come. He didn't visit Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam inquired. So that person came. And the answer was that his child had passed away. That's why he had stopped coming. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to that father, that, oh father, you know that child? That same child will be waiting for you on the doors of Jannah. When you will pass away, when you will be resurrected, that same child will be waiting for you on the doors of Jannah. In another narration, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that whoever has two child and they both pass away, they will make their parents enter Jannah. They will make their parents enter Jannah. So one Sahabi said, what about those parents who've only lost one child? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, even them, because they've lost one child, okay, that child on the day of judgment will make them enter Jannah. Why are these virtues for these people, for these parents? Because the pain is so much. This is why even Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he had his third boy child, Ibrahim, okay? He's a prophet. Ibrahim, when in one narration it is stated that as he was passing away, again in infancy, tears started flowing down his eyes. I started crying. And someone inquired about this. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that إِنَّ الْعَيْنَ تَدْمَعْ وَالْقَلْبُ يَحْزُنْ. That verily my tears are flowing and my heart is grieved. وَإِنَّ لِمُفَارِقِكَ يَا إِبْرَاهِيمُ لَمَحْزُونُونَ. That, oh Ibrahim, on your separation I am grieved. You know, this shows that Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's shedding tears. He is finding it hard. And tears are flowing down his cheek. Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once after performing salah, he would often ask the sahabas, oh my sahabas, have you seen any dreams? So sometimes sahabas would mention their dreams. Once the sahabas didn't mention any dream. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, today I'm going to mention to you about my dream. And Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I went to sleep and I was shown Jannah. And in Jannah I saw so many little children. And in the midst of all these little children, there was a tall man. And I asked, now who are these people in Jannah? So the angel said, that this tall man who you are seeing, this is Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. And these children which you are seeing, these are all the children who are under the age of puberty, fitra, they passed away. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam thereafter asked, what about those children who were mushrikeen? Who were the children of those who disbelieved in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What about them? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was given the answer that even they Even they are here in Jannah. Those people who have passed away under the age of puberty, and they were, their parents were non-Muslims, even they will be in Jannah, according to this narration. So, those people who have lost their young ones, there's a great reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for them, for losing a child. And as I said, only a mother will understand that pain. Because even when we had our first daughter, she passed away. She lived for a couple of hours and she left this world. And only a mother knows what they go through. Why? Because they go through so much because of the anticipation, because of all the thoughts and all the things which they have thought will do with this child, okay, and everything which they bought. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes it from. This is why that first daughter which we had, she passed away. When it came to naming her, we named her Sumayya. Because Sumayya radiallahu ta'ala anha was the first person to give her life for this deen. She gave that sacrifice and she passed away. And all the sacrifice which people will do, okay, she will get the reward because she was the first person to give that sacrifice. So because of that, we named our first child Sumayya. So those who have lost their children, okay, there's great reward, not only in this world, but that child will be waiting, okay, and will be the reason for you to enter Jannah. So Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he lost Abdullah, okay. So his first child was Abdullah, he lost him. Then he had four consecutive daughters, Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha, Umm Kulthum radiallahu ta'ala anha, Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha, Ruqayya radiallahu ta'ala anha, Umm Kulthum radiallahu ta'ala anha, Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha, in order. And then he had another child, a boy. So the first child, he named him Qasim. And the second child, he named him Abdullah. And again, only those parents will know that when you have that second child, the anticipation. And this second child, in terms of male, was Abdullah. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam obviously was so happy with Abdullah. He lived for 1 year, 2 years. And in infancy, even he passed away. So in one narration, it is stated that Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Hazrat Khadija, the house which they had, okay, their neighbor was Abu Lahab. Okay? The one who was the worst enemy of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So in one narration it is stated that when, because neighbors are the first people to find out the news. This is why there's so much rights of neighbors. Okay? Because of them being next to us. That's another topic of neighbors and the respect which we should show our neighbors. This is why when the Jewish neighbor of Abdullah ibn Mubarak, when he was selling his house, okay, he put his house for like 2,000, I don't even remember the exact figure, dirham. And someone asked him that your house is only worth 1,000 and he put it for 2,000, double. What was his reply? Yes, 1,000 because of my house, that's how much it's worth. But 1,000 because of having Abdullah ibn Mubarak as a neighbor. Neighbor makes a difference. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam neighbor was Abu Lahab. So when he found out that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has lost his child and he was the first person to find out, he went out in the streets telling people that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has become abtar. So abtar means a person who has cut off. A person. So abtar in the Arabic dictionary means a person, an animal whose tail has been cut off. It's a word used for humiliation. Okay, meaning what he was trying to say is, look at Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's sharing his message, but his legacy is cut off. His son has passed away. Who's gonna keep up with his legacy? Because legacy is normally fed through a male children. Okay, so who's gonna keep up with his legacy? He's cut off. We don't need to worry about him. So this is one narration that this is what happened. And this is why this surah came. The other reason scholars have mentioned is once Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was talking to a person called Asim ibn Wa'il. Prophet spoke to him, and then Asim ibn Wa'il went away. And then few people met Asim ibn Wa'il and said to Asim ibn Wa'il, "Oh Asim ibn Wa'il, who are you just talking to over there?" And instead of saying Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, instead of, he's a non-Muslim, what did he say? He started talking bad about Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the words which he used was abtar. I was talking to an abtar. Astaghfirullah, na'udhu billah. Meaning that person who has been cut off, who has been... Now could you imagine the pain of Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He's going through physical pain anyway. Okay? Why? Because when Abdullah was born and when Abdullah passed away, he had received prophethood. He had already received prophethood. And when he received prophethood, scholars have mentioned that after 2 years, people started torturing him, giving him hard times, giving him emotional torture, physical torture, psychological torture. In the midst of all these tortures, and now his son has passed away, and now they're giving him even more grievance. And this is so sad because, you know, even now, okay, when someone has an enemy, okay, you don't cross that limit. The limit of that if his child has passed away, even an enemy shows some type of leniency. But these enemies were such, that in the time when his son has passed away, when he is drowned in emotion, and these people are not even leaving him alone, and they are calling him abtar, that you are cut off, your legacy is not going to carry on, who's going to listen to you? And in the midst of all this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals Suratul Kauthar. So Suratul Kauthar is like is consoling Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You could put it in that way. Suratul Kauthar is consoling Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam because of the grievance which these people were giving. So this is why Suratul Kauthar is very short. And it's probably a surah which everyone reads in their salah. You know, because it's a short surah, it's probably a surah which everyone has, meaning it's in their mind to read Inna A'tainaka al-Kauthar automatically. If it's a 2 rakah, so many people just read Inna A'tainaka al-Kauthar and Suratul Ikhlas. Inna A'tainaka al-Kauthar, Suratul Ikhlas. Inna A'tainaka, it's because it's a short. But from today, when we recite Suratul Kauthar, okay, for I don't know how long we've been reading Suratul Kauthar in Salah. We've been reading it because it's the shortest. But let's change our niyyah. Let's change our intention. That this is, we're not reading just because it's the most shortest now. We're reading it because it is the most comprehensive surah. Inshallah, once the tafsir session will end and we understand the maqam of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so our intention should change why we're reading Suratul Kauthar. Not because it's the shortest, but because it is a comprehensive surah explaining the maqam and the status of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So I will start what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts Suratul Kauthar. So he says, Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar, that verily we have given you Kauthar. فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ, so read salah to your Lord. وَنْحَرْ, and do qurbani. وَنْحَرْ means sacrifice. إِنَّ شَانِئَكَ, verily your enemies. شَانِئ means enemies. Those who have enmity against you. إِنَّ شَانِئَكَ, verily your enemies. هُوَ الْأَبْتَرْ, they are cut off. They're telling you that you're cut off. هُوَ الْأَبْتَرْ, they are cut off. So this is the surah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts the surah with inna, inna. Inna, inna. When you want to say a statement, okay, you can just say a statement. Okay. But if you want to strengthen that statement, in Arabic you use inna, verily, indeed. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says inna. Inna means we. Inna means we. Inni means me. Inna means we. Inna. Scholars have mentioned that why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and in the Quran you will find this, inna nahnu nazzalna dhikr, inna nahnu, inna, we. Whereas Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one. Scholars have mentioned the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used we is to show the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because in we, you can sense the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about his ibadah, the worship, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there he will not use we, the worship we. No. He will always use singular, worship me. وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي. وَعْبُدْ رَبَّكَ حَتَّى يَعْتِيَقَ الْيَقِينَ. And other parts where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks, the worship, there he will not say worship us, worship me. To make people understand that I am not more than one, I am singular. Where I am using nahnu and inna, we, is always where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about his greatness. When someone says that, so one is I will sort you out, and one is we will sort you out. You see that greatness, that they say the royal we. So inna, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is consoling Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by saying inna, verily we, a'atayinaka, we will give you, a'atayinaka, we have given you. A'atayina, to give, ka is you. So ka, whenever ka comes, means you. Because this surah is revealed to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so ka, you, is Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So a'atayinaka, verily we, a'atayinaka, we have given you, already given you. Wa al-kawthar. Al-kawthar. Now, the whole discussion, and I mentioned in the beginning, scholars have spoken 5-6 hours on this surah, have written pages after pages, volume after volume on this surah. Not only on this surah, just on this word Kauthar. Because Kauthar is the word which explains to us the maqam of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Inna a'tainaka al-Kauthar. Al-Kauthar. Question comes, what is Kauthar? Imam Fakhruddin Razi rahmatullahi alayhi, in his kitab, he has mentioned there are approximately 15 different interpretation of Kauthar. What could Kauthar mean? Okay, and each interpretation you can talk volumes after volumes. It could mean this, it could mean this, it could mean this, it could mean this, it could mean this. But I will only cover two main things. From all the 15, just two. So the first meaning, which scholars have mentioned, that Al-Kawthar means, okay, Kawthar comes from the word Kathir. Kathir means a lot. Kathir means a lot. Kawthar means not just a lot. Kawthar, okay, it's an exaggeration of Kathir, Kathra. Abundance of good. Okay, a scholar mentioned this very beautifully. So for example, if you have a cup, okay, and you fill the cup with water to the top, you will say kathir, there's too much water here. So that's kathir. Then if it flows, you will say kathur. Okay, this is overflowing, this is too much. And then you have kawthar, okay, which is far beyond that. Okay, abundance in goodness. Inna a'atainaka al-kawthar. O Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have given you abundance. We have given you abundance in goodness. This is what it means. If you take it, this translation. Abundance in goodness. Now scholars have mentioned that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says abundance in goodness, what does he mean? Abundance in goodness in what? Then scholars have mentioned that what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to say, that O Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not only are you a source of abundance, not only you are a source of abundance, but whatever is linked to you, whatever is attached to you, that is and will become a source of abundance or a blessing or goodness. We have given you this, O Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is why whatever was attached to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because of the attachment with Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it became great, it became abundant. This is what Al-Kawthar means. One word, but it's such a comprehensive word. It's like, you know, in dua, okay, we learn many duas. The Prophet ﷺ said the most comprehensive dua from all the duas is this dua, is afiyat. One word, afiyat. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once told Abbas, Abbas radiallahu ta'ala once asked Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, teach me a comprehensive dua, which encapsulates everything. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, salil afiyah, ask for afiyat. What does afiyat mean? One word. It means every goodness, free from every distress, free from illness, free from every bad thing. When you are free from every bad thing, from every problem, from every monetary problem, from every financial problem, from every family problem, from every problem, not only in this world, but even in the hereafter. This is what you call afiyah. When you say afiyah, oh Allah, I ask afiyah from you, this is what you're asking. So Abbas radiallahu ta'ala, he came to Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once again. And he said, oh Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, can you teach me another dua? Because he thought that this dua was a bit short. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Abbas radiallahu ta'ala an, O Abbas radiallahu ta'ala an, he said to the nearest meaning, verily that person who has been given afiyat, he has been given everything. That person who has been given afiyat, he has been given everything. So this is one short dua. So short, afiyat. This is why it comes in hadith, the Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, every morning he would ask for afiyat. Because Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that whoever u'tit al-afwa wal-afiyah, whoever has been given afiyat, faqad aflaht, that person has succeeded. So this is one of the du'as which we should start reciting every single day, that, oh Allah, I ask afiyat from you. Allahumma inni as'aluka al-afiyah. Inni as'aluka al-afiyah. Every time ask. So this is one word which has the meaning of every goodness and free from every illness within one word. So Kauthar is one of them words. Abundance in goodness, meaning all that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is training Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that not only you are a source of rahmah, but whatever is attached to you, we will make that into an abundance. This is why whatever was connected to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is why scholars have talked hours and hours. Because now you are talking about the status of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And how can you end the topic on the status of Nabi Kareem? You can't. If you start from his body, okay, for example, I'll give an example. If you just talk about his feet, about his presence, about his feet, okay, then Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was in Makkah al-Mukarramah. At that time, Medina al-Munawwara was known as Yathrib, a place where, a diseased place. Whenever someone used to visit Medina, at that time it's called Yathrib, they would become diseased. This is why when Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam migrated to Medina, Yathrib at that time it was called, as Aisha Siddiqa says, wahiya awba'wa, that it was the most diseased place. That anyone who would visit or who would start living in Yathrib, they would become ill. And so many people would pass away. And as Abubakr radiallahu ta'ala, as Bilal radiallahu ta'ala, so many Sahabas became ill. This is why scholars mention that this is when Sahaba started reading their salah sitting down. But when Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam entered Medina, Yathrib, what happened? It became Madinatul Munawwara. That same Yathrib, which was the most diseased, okay, became source of rahmah. It became Madinatul Munawwara. That place where Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that masjid of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that what happened to that masjid? It became Masjid al-Nabawi, the greatest of all the masjid. Where do you think Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam walked the most? He will have been between his house and the place where he reads salah. From his house to salah. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَا بَيْنَ بَيْتِي وَمِنْبَرِي رَوْضَةٌ مِّنْ رِيَازِ الْجَنَّةِ. That part which is between my house and the place, minbar, meaning near where he is performing salah, that area, okay, is a garden from the Garden of Jannah. Scholars have mentioned, what does this mean? It's a piece from Jannah. That land is actually a piece of Jannah. So the place he moved became Madinat al-Munawwara. The masjid, his masjid became Masjid al-Nabawi. The place where he walked the most became Rawdatun min Riyad al-Jannah. What about the place where he was staying, where he lived, where he has left this world? Scholars have mentioned, and they say this is a unanimous agreement from all the scholars, that soil which is touching the beloved body of Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that soil, not Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the soil which is touching the body of Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has got more status than the arsh. The arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the soil, scholars have mentioned in agreement that the soil has got more maqam and has got more status in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not the body, we're not even touching the body yet. Nabi Akram himself, we're just saying about the soil which is touching the body of Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The old Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they are making fun out of you. This is something which I have given you. Inna atainaka al-kawthar. That verily we have given you abundance of goodness. If this is the feet, then what about the hands? The hands of Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it turns towards the moon. And what happens? The moon splits. Sahaba says that once we were in Hudaybiyah, about 1,500 sahabas were with us, and Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the time of salah has come. So we went looking for water, we couldn't find water. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, give me a little bit of water. And then Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the sahaba says, we saw from the fingers of Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam water running down. This is Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So how can we talk about Nabi Karim sallam? How can we talk about his mercy? Because if we just talk about his mercy, we need hours and hours. Every prophet, okay, if their people didn't believe the message of their prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala principle was that he would demolish them. A miracle would come, they would stop believing, demolish. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, O Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَأَنْتَ فِيهِمْ. O Nabiya Kareem, I will not give punishment in the sense that I will destroy everyone and you're in them. I will not do that. Because of you, I will not bring a punishment like that. This is the mercy of Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because of Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahu Akbar. I'm just thinking, what else? Like, there's so much we can talk about the status of Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The maqam of Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even, you know, this Fatihah Makkah, scholars have mentioned something so beautiful. And I found it, when I heard it, I found it so amazing. Okay? Because scholars, mashallah, they've spent hours and hours, their whole life has been behind Quran and looking at Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the way they deduce things, okay, it makes a person wonder, Allahu Akbar, how were they able to deduce this? The rahmah of Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So I was listening, that it is the principle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that when a prophet, he sends a message, okay, and the people don't listen, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in their life does something, gives a miracle. Through that miracle, everyone starts believing. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what he does, once he brings that miracle, he destroys them. He destroys them. Who doesn't believe in the miracle? He destroys them. So after miracle, after seeing the truthfulness of Islam, the dealing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that he finishes everyone. So if you look in the life of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, okay, Fathi Makkah, you know Fathi Makkah, which happened in 8th Hijri? That was the time, it was like a miracle. Because Islam became such a truth in front of people that no one could deny. that Islam is a truthful religion. This is why so many people, even Abu Sufyan and others, who were the worst before the enemies, they became radiyallahu ta'ala and ikrama radiyallahu. Because that was the time which showed the truthfulness of Islam. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't punish those people who didn't believe in Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But in opposite to that, when these people came, okay, and they conquered Makkah al-Mukarramah, they were saying, Al-Yawmu Yawmu al-Malhama, that today is a day of revenge. The Sahabas were saying, today is a day of revenge. Because 13 years in Makkah al-Mukarramah, they made their life hard, and now 8 years, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did he say? Al-Yawmu Yawmu al-Malhama. No, today is a day of mercy. Today is a day of showing that mercy to those people. To those people who would say abtar to Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To those people who would give emotional torture to Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To those people who give physical torture to Nabiya Kareem. Al-yawmu yawmul marhama. So inshallah, what I'm trying to say is, Al-Kawthar, we can talk hours and hours regarding the status of Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And at the end, we have to say what that poet said. Ba'adiz khuda buzruk tuvi. To put a full stop to this subject, ba'adiz khuda buzruk tuvi qissa mukhtasa. That your status is after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, full stop, qissa mukhtasa. How can we talk on the maqam of you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? We cannot with our tongue talk about. So, inna atainaka al-kawthar, one meaning is, O Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have given you al-kawthar. Abundance of goodness in everything, in you and whatever is attached to you. Okay, this is why, you know, there has never been in history, okay, that in 23 years, because Prophet lived for, he received Prophet at the age of 40, so 40 to 60, 23 years, he revolutionized the whole Arabia. Could you imagine in 23 years, okay, he changed the dynamic of this world in 23 years. One person, and he did this. So let's put a full stop. بعد خدا بزرگ تو بی قصة مختصر أو نبي كريم صلى الله عليه وسلم. We can never. Al-Kawthar means praising Nabiya Kareem صلى الله عليه وسلم, and we can never praise you, O Nabiya Kareem صلى الله عليه وسلم. And then you have the other meaning, Al-Kawthar. And this meaning was a meaning which Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself said, what Kawthar means. So one thing scholars have mentioned is, sometimes a surah or a verse would be revealed two times or three times. The same surah or the same verse sometimes would be revealed two times, three times. Because this narration is about Medina al-Munawwara. That once Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to sleep and the Sahabas were there, and Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he woke up and he had a smile on his face. So the Sahabas asked, why are you smiling? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied that just now, Suratul Kawthar was revealed to me. And then he read, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Inna a'atainaka al-kawthar, fasalli li rabbika wanhar, inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar. And then he said to the Sahabas, oh Sahabas, do you know what al-kawthar means here? So the Sahabas says, no. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at that time said, and this is the meaning which Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-Kawthar here. Al-Kawthar is the cistern, is the hose, is the pond which I will be given on the day of judgment, how the Kawthar. And then he explained regarding how the Kawthar in this hadith. So this is what Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. How Kawthar in this narration means that. This is why Imam Fakhruddin Razi has said, there's 15 meanings you can take. And you can take all meaning, because all meaning are right. You can take the first meaning and the second meaning. So, hold. Now a question arises here. There's a question here. Okay? That Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that in Jannah, you know when Mi'raj happened, Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was taken and he was given a tour of this world and of the first, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, heaven, and he saw everything. And he was taken to Jannah. And in Jannah, he was shown a river. And the angel said, this
And Prophet in that hadith actually describes that river. Okay, it was whiter than milk. The fragrance was like musk. It was sweeter than honey. And then when he inquired about this river, the angel said, "This is your river. And this is the river of Kauthar, which you will be given. And which you have been given." So scholars have tried to reconcile. Now, is Kauthar the pond or the cistern or... cistern or pond is where you keep water. Is Kauthar the pond which is reserved for Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in the day of Qiyamah? Is that what Kauthar is? Or is Kauthar that river which is in Jannah? So then, scholars have mentioned that there's a hadith which reconciles both hadith. Because in another hadith, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says that I will be given a hawd on the day of Qiyamah. And that hawd, the water, okay, will be coming, the water supply to that hawd, to that pond, or to that cistern, will be coming from Jannah, and will be coming from Kauthar. There will be two pipes, and this comes in hadith, a pipe of gold and a pipe of silver, which will run from Jannah, and it will supply from that Kauthar to this pond. This is why you can call this pond Hawd al-Kauthar, and you can call that the fountain of Kauthar. They both Kauthar. The main Kauthar is in Jannah, but and the water which will be supplied in this hall, which will be on the Day of Judgment, will be coming from the Kauthar. So now, let's discuss about what is this Kauthar Hawd, which Nabi Karim has mentioned. So you see, this Kauthar, when everyone will pass away and when everyone will resurrect, okay, it will be a turmoil everywhere. Okay, no one will know what's happening. Okay, just imagine you've just woken up and you don't know what's happening. Like you look left, you look right, you've got no clothes. Okay, and you don't know where you are. Okay, the sun is there, people are drowning. Okay, so when this will be happening, okay, and people wouldn't know what's happening, okay, and you know, one of the worst thing is anticipation, okay, when you're in that doctor's line, okay, you just want to know that result, okay, that way is no good for you, okay, so this way, okay, so it comes, scholars have mentioned, that people will go around looking for people who can actually speak to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to start the day of resurrection. So people will go to Adam alayhi salam, scholars have mentioned, and he will say, "I can't face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of that fruit which I ate." Then like this, they will go to different prophets. And then one prophet will say, "Now why do you go to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi salam?" And then when this group will go to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi salam, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will say, "Ya ummati, ya ummati." And then this Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and before even asking, he will prostrate in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for 7 days and for 7 nights. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, "Irfa ra'asak." O Nabi Kareem, O Muhammad, lift your head. What do you want to ask? And this is when Nabi Kareem will say, "Now start the Day of Judgment. These people are waiting, start the Day of Judgment." And the Day of Reckoning will start. Okay, the scales will be brought. I don't want to go into details, okay? Because then there'll be another hour. But okay, then after this, okay, some say before this and some say after this, what will happen is the groups will be made, Jannah, Jahannam, okay, and everyone will be told to go to an area, okay, so every group, okay, will be told to go to their leader. So just imagine, okay, when we were small in a school, we used to have fire alarm. Okay, we used to go out, we used to be told that go to your leader, go to your teacher, and whoever your teacher was, you learn. So every group will have to go to their leader. Okay, so Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam's people will go to Nuh alayhi salam. Hud alayhi salam's people will go to Hud alayhi salam. Salih alayhi salam's people will go to Salih alayhi salam. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam's ummah, as Allahu Akbar, will be taken to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's where the horse, that pond will be. So Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam once explained that how big will this horse be, this pond or this cistern. He said in one narration that if a person was to get on an animal and was to run for 30 days, the amount of miles or kilometers of the whatever he will pass, okay, in that 30 days, that's how big that pond will be. And the pond will be square. The pond will be square. And in there will be that water, the Hawd al-Kawthar. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that this water will be whiter than milk, sweeter than, because it's coming from Jannah, Kawthar. And in the bank, next to that well, or next to this cistern or pond, will be all glasses. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that there will be so many glasses to the amount which is equivalent to the stars. You know, when it's all dark and you can see so many millions and billions of stars, that's how many cups will be laid next to this pond. And in one narration, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then describes what will happen. Okay, so that narration is the narration of Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala. That once Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was visiting Qabristan, graveyard, and then he said to the Sahabas that وَرِدْتُ أَنِّي لَقِيْتُ إِخْوَانِي, that I just have this desire to meet my brothers. So Hazrat Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu replied that أَوَلَسْنَا إِخْوَانِ, that are we not your brothers? Allahu Akbar. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you are my companions. My brothers, who I refer to as my brothers, they will come after me. They will believe in me. And yet they will not have seen me. My brothers are those, Allahu Akbar. He called us his brothers. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِي وَلَمْ يَرَوْنِي. They will believe in me. And they will not even have seen me. I wish to see them. And then Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to Abu Hurairah, oh Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala an. No. Then, has Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, but how will you recognize them on the Day of Judgment? You're saying your brother, but how will you recognize them on the Day of Judgment? That'd be like from Adam al Islam till the last person. And then Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you know, whenever Prophet had to explain, he would explain in so simple words that everyone would understand. Instead of giving, you know, long commentary, he said to Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala, oh Abu Hurairah, if a person has so many pitched black horses, and in the midst of all these pitch black horses, there are some stripy horses, would you recognize them? He said, yeah, of course, stripy horses. He said, just like you would recognize that on the Day of Judgment, my ummati, their faces and their feet will be glowing. This is why in this world, we are called Muslim. But on the Day of Judgment, our title will be Ghurrul or Ghurrul Muhajjaloon. Those people whose limbs are glowing. Limbs are glowing. And Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you know why these limbs will be glowing of them? Because of the athar, because of wuzu. Because of wuzu. This is why. This is not a muftabihi qawl. I don't want people acting upon this. This is why when Hazrat Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala heard this from Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to do wuzu and he used to wash his hands up to here. And he would say, those who are listening at home, what would you call this? Shoulder, yeah, up to his shoulder. Beginning of his shoulder. That I want all this to be glowing on the Day of Judgment. So that's how I will recognize my people. Okay? And Prophet said, and these people, okay, they will be bought near Hawd al-Kawthar. And the words which Nabi Karim Sassam used, Allahu Akbar, you know, how can we ever talk about Nabi Karim Sassam? Farat, he used Farat. Okay? And Farat means, okay, that you go in advance. A Farat means that you're waiting for someone. Okay? You go in advance and then you wait for someone. Okay, for example, if we are at home and a great sheikh was to come in this masjid, okay, we will come in this masjid beforehand to host that big sheikh. Prophet Sassam says that I will be already there on the Hawd al-Kawthar waiting for my ummati to come. For it, I will be waiting for them to come. And then he explains to Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala, and then I will be there. Okay? Allahu Akbar. And the ummati lines will be made. This is why Nabi, so basically every Nabi will get a hod, will get a pond. And on each pond, each prophet will have their people. This is why Nabi Karim said, okay, that I want my horse or my people to be in abundant, to be so much, so that I could be proud that look how many people I've got. This is why Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a hadith that tazawwajud walud, that when you get married to a lady who gives lots of children. What's the hikmah? Because of, so that it increases, and on the day of judgment I will have so many followers. And this is something he's proud of. So everyone will be waiting. And this is the first time scholars have mentioned, because I was listening to a scholar. This is the first time, Allahu Akbar. This is the first time when the ummati of Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will see Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam face to face. Could you believe it? For all these years, people sacrificed for Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They've been talking about Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We've been listening about Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. People have given their life for Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there you come face to face with that person, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he's there waiting. So this is why, you know, this hadith was told to Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala. But obviously Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala told this hadith, told this narration to so many people. And just like we know this hadith, Sahabas knew this hadith. And one person who actually knew this story on this ayah was Hazrat Bilal radiallahu ta'ala. Okay? So Bilal radiallahu ta'ala, okay, when Prophet passed away, Bilal radiallahu ta'ala had so much love for Nabiya Kareem, he could have stayed in Madinah al-Munawwar. When he gave that first azan, he could have finished the azan. This is why he came to Hazrat Abubakr. Because Abubakr radiallahu ta'ala was the one who actually bought Bilal radiallahu ta'ala. He's the one who freed him from Umayyah bin Khalf. So he said, said to Hazrat Abubakr, "Oh Abubakr, if you freed me for yourself, then I will stay in Medina. Then I am yours. But if you freed me for the sake of Allah, then it is my intention that I go in the path of Allah." Could you imagine the love of Nabi? So he leaves for Sham. And then he comes, that after so many, I don't know, months, weeks, okay, he sees Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asks, "Oh Bilal, how come you're not visiting us, Medina?" So poet has said, okay, that as he is coming, okay, could you imagine, okay, all the thoughts which will be going through the mind of Bilal radiallahu ta'ala, as he is coming, he is remembering the nasihat and the advice which Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave, okay, that, "Oh Bilal," because Bilal radiallahu ta'ala went through so much suffering, you know, from all the sahabas, the most Bilal radiallahu ta'ala went through, okay, that sabr to mutana, sabr, just do sabr, okay, and then he's remembering those advice which was given to Bilal radiallahu ta'ala on the personal level. He's remembering the advice which Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave, the last advice, that Quran, and keep up with the Quran and the Sunnah, okay, and then he remembers this advice, this about Hawdha Kawthar. Okay? So the poet says, and I will just say, so when I'm saying it, okay, just imagine Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is there and he's waiting for the Ummah. Okay? So Hazrat Bilal radiallahu ta'ala is coming into Madinat al-Munawwara, and the thoughts, okay, and he just can't walk. He's walking, but okay. Qadam he Bilal aj, chalne se'ari, lo ab alwida, alwida-e hamari, ye lo mera Qur'an, ye lo meri sunnat, ye lo mera Quran, ye lo meri sunnat, ye dikh layegi tumko abrahe jannat. Pari jo musibat, sabr tum uthana, magar dil kisi ka na hargiz dukhana. Agar waha na ho to Kauthar par milunga, agar waha na ho to Kauthar par milunga. Main ummat ko pyaasi jaane na dunga, bujhaunga tishna labi ki tumhari. Lo ab alvida, alvida hai hamari. Agar waha na ho to arsh par milunga, agar waha na ho to arsh par milunga. Main ro ro ke haq se duaye karunga, karunga waha pe aho zari tumhari. Lo ab alvida, alvida hai hamari.
So this will be the first time, scholars have mentioned, where a person will be able to see the blessed face of Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam further stated to Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala that that the people will be in lines, okay? And then Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and in one narration the angels will be giving the water of Kauthar. Okay? Whoever drinks this water of Kauthar, okay, they will never become hungry. So people in Jannah, when they will eat and they will drink, it will not be because of hunger, it will be because of enjoyment. And I'd like to just mention something here. If people understand, they understand. If people don't, it's okay. Hunger will not be in Jannah. Hunger is in this world. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to sustain this world, He has made other requirements to sustain this world. This world can be sustained because of two things. This world, to sustain this world, there has to be two things happening. One is a person remains alive, and the progeny keeps on going. If a person keeps on dying, he's alive and he dies, then how can this world keep intact? This world be empty. So this world, for this world to run, okay, you need to sustain people. Okay, people need to stay alive. And the other is progeny, okay, children, okay, needs to keep on coming. Okay, that's how this world. To sustain this world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for sustain a person, okay, that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept two enjoyment. One is thirst. The reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept hunger and thirst is so that when a person becomes hungry and thirsty, he will eat. If there was no thirst, if there was no hunger in this world, then people would just die. People would eat. That's one of the hikmah, one of the wisdom why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept this quality within us, that we feel hungry, we feel thirsty, so that we remain alive. And that's why, there's adults here, adults listening at home probably. That's why there's enjoyment in fulfilling the desire with your spouse. Why is there desire there? Why has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kept enjoyment in there? To keep this progeny going. Because if there's no enjoyment in the act, then would people do the act? No. If people didn't do the act, then would there be progeny?
growing? No. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deliberately keep that enjoyment there, so that the progeny keeps on going. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept this and said that when you get married, then only this is halal. If you do this act outside of marriage or with another person, there's so much punishment for this person. Why? Because I have only kept this for that time. To sustain this progeny, I have given enjoyment, yes, in that, so that this world keeps on running. This is on the side. So after drinking this water, Zamzam, in Jannah, there'll be no hunger and there'll be no thirst. You'll be drinking through for enjoyment. Then Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that I will be giving water out, and then I will see angels who will be taking people out of the lines. Taking people out of the lines. So I will ask, that why are you taking these people out? Are these not the Ghurul Muhajjalun? These are from my ummah. Why are you taking these people out? So the angel will reply, O Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that you do not know what these people did after you. You do not know what these people did after you. And then there's different narration as to what the angel will say. Now what did they do? Some narration says that they bought new things in Islam. Bid'at. And there's other narrations as well. Prophet said, Allah, could you imagine? He'll become so upset that he will say, suhqan, suhqan, take them away. Take them away from here. Take them away. That Nabi, who is so rahmatul lil alameen, and that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make us from them. That the first time you're going to see Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then you, okay, I told you, over here when you're in the line and the police comes, can you step aside? Can you step aside? The angel on that day, can you step aside? And they, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make us from them. So this is the Hawdhi Kawthar, okay? So after drinking so everyone, every ummati of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be able to see Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and will be given this water, and from this water the quench, the thirst and the hunger will be taken away. Okay, so this is Hawdhi Kawthar as well, and there's Kawthar in Jannah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allahu Akbar, Allah is 850, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that, O Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have given you Al-Kawthar. They are saying all this, we have given you, already given you, Al-Kawthar. Now remember, this is consoling Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, okay? Because of what he's going through. So, if you want to understand this in a context, okay? What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to say to Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Just imagine there's a poor person, he's suffering after suffering. And then someone comes up to him and says, oh person, here's the envelope. Take this envelope. There's 10 million pound check inside. Keep this envelope. This is yours. But don't open it. After 1 month, open this. After 1 month, open this. But this is yours. Take this envelope. That person, he will go through the pain. He'll go through the suffering. The back of his head, he knows, after a month, I'm going to get that 10 million pounds. That is going to motivate him. That incentive is such that it's going to keep him going. He will go through all the torture because he knows, after 1 month, I'm going to get this. And inshallah, after I get that, all my problems are going to be removed. O Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you are going through all this. Inna a'atainaka al-kawthar. Verily, we have given you kawthar. We have given you kawthar. It's already there for you. Yes, you will go through pain. Yes, you will go through suffering. You will go through emotional things, but remember, I have given you this. Keep that in mind, and this will motivate you. So you can understand this verse in that context, consoling Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Inna a'atainaka al-kawthar. The next, if you're okay to stay, I'll carry on. If you want to leave, then the next verse which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, because if I do this next week, then I will be able to truly link then again. I'll have to talk about Inna Atinaka al-Kawthar again. I don't know, shall I carry on? So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar. Verily we have given you kawthar. Okay? Remember, the shani nuzul, the background of this surah, that it's been revealed because of abtar, because of them slandering Nabiya, saying bad things to Nabiya. So and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is consoling Nabiya Kareem with these words. Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar. We have given you al-kawthar. Abundance is good. The river in Jannah, the house in the day of Qiyamah. Fa means so. Because I've given you fa, so. So that now you need to, what do you need to do? Fasalli li rabbik. What you need to do is read your salah, read salah, salli. Read salah li rabbik to your Lord. Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, salli here means the five times salah. Could you imagine? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is at his lowest. He is going through torture and then emotional, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is advising him and is telling him, read your salah. Read your salah. Salli li rabbik. Read your salah. Why? Many reasons. Number one, salli li rabbik. This will strengthen you. Salli li rabbik. This will strengthen you. What you're going through, you will find strength in salli li rabbik. Because in the connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see, for example, if you're a CEO of a company, okay? A manager of a company, a CEO of a company, he goes to meet a sick person, okay? And that sick person is going through so much. He gives him, he consoles him. And then he says, you know what, you're going through a lot. Here, take my number. Whenever you need me, yeah, take it. This is my connection with you. Whenever you need me, this is me. This is a way of contacting me. Salli li rabbik, O Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One way of connecting to me, salli li rabbik. Read your salah. Because salah comes from sila. Sila means connection. Okay? The lowest moment, one of the lowest moments of his life, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is advising him, is telling him, read salah. Salah. The highest moment in the time of Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was what? Mi'raj. And over there, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give him? Salah. The last words of Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, salah. And yet, there's people not reading salah. Meaning, how can a Muslim not read salah? Which is for us, given to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which is not even sunnah, which is not even like mustab. It's for us to read salah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, salli li rabbik. Read salah to your Lord. And again, we can talk so much about salah, okay? And I don't want to talk so much, okay? So salli li rabbik. So strengthen yourself by what? Salli li rabbik, by reading salah. Reading salah meaning have connection with Allah, because in salah you are connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why when Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came down in Mi'raj and he told the sahabas about salah, the sahabas got so happy. Why? Why did they get so happy? Because salah is a way of connecting. It's like conversing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Could you imagine? In a day, you don't get a chance of conversing directly to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In salah, you're actually conversing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why when we did Surah Al-Fatihah, I mentioned that when a person recites Surah Al-Fatihah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is replying to his... So one is, Salli Rabbik, O Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, strengthen, get strength, فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكْ, by reading salah. Scholars have mentioned, there's another way of looking at this verse as well. Salli li rabbik, O Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because I have given you kawthar, which is the greatest blessing. Okay? If you take the first meaning, the second meaning, or the other 13 meaning which mentioned in Tafsir and Razi. Fasalli li rabbik. Thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by reading salah. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whenever He mentions a blessing in the Quran, whenever He gives a blessing, He always expects us to thank Him. Thank Him, to do shukr. And the greatest way of thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is what? Is by reading salah. Salli li rabbik. I have given you kawthar. Thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that. By what? Fasalli li rabbik. By reading your salah to li rabbik, to your Lord, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So strengthen and thankness. Okay? So this is why it's very important that whenever we are blessed with blessing, we always thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The greatest way of thanking is salah. Five times salah is the greatest way of thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But even small blessings which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us, we should be thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It doesn't matter if it's small. It doesn't matter if you do it every day. If you eat every day. Even for that food, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once came out of masjid, he was really hungry. And he found Hazrat Abubakr and Hazrat Umar. Prophet asked, why are you here in the masjid at this very odd time? They said, we are hungry. Prophet said, I am hungry too. You are hungry. Let's go. Let's find someone who will give us food. So one Ansari said, I will invite you to my house. So Prophet ﷺ, Hazrat Abu Bakr and Hazrat Umar, they ate. I'm doing very quick. They ate. And then Prophet ﷺ started crying. And they said, why are you crying after food? Prophet ﷺ said, ثُمَّ لَتُسْأَلُنَّ يَوْمَ إِذِنْ عَنِ النَّعِيمِ. He read this verse in one narration. He said to Hazrat Abu Bakr and Hazrat Umar and the host, that I am crying because even on this, the food which we had, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask us on the blessings which I have given you. What did you do with that blessing? So every blessing, no matter if it's food, so small, we should be thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ shows that thankness and strength. Find strength and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ and wanhar. Wanhar, and wanhar means qurbani, and do qurbani, slaughter. So wanhar is specially used when you are doing qurbani of a camel. Okay? Scholar, I'm going very fast now. So scholar mentioned, why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention wanhar? That by mentioning fasalli rabbik, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in one way is trying to say, do shukr. Salah is the greatest of all the worship, but all the bodily worship. And wanhar, all the worship which is done through wealth, which is done one heart through wealth, through money. Okay, so through your body do your worship, and through your wealth one heart thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the greatest way of thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is being generous, is being the most generous. And from all the dhabah which a person can do dhabah of a cow, of a sheep, of a goat, the greatest is camel. Okay, and wanhar, okay, means to slaughter a camel. Wanhar exclusively means, zabah means general zabah, general slaughter. But wanhar, when a person means nahar, wanhar, it means exclusively slaughtering a camel, which is the highest. Okay, so salli, highest salah, and wanhar, highest camel. So do shukr by your bodily, and do shukr by your wealth. Okay, and by your health, by your wealth, by serving others. Okay, by, for example, when you're slaughtering, okay, what will happen? That meat will go to other people. Okay, and other people will eat. Okay, so in a way, if you look at it, okay, find happiness, find your strength by helping others as well. By helping others, okay, you will find happiness. Got so much to say on one hal, but I will now just go to the next sentence. Because this is the main sentence. This is why the whole surah was revealed. Okay. Inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar. Verily, inna shani'aka, your enemies, those people who are saying bad things, and not only them, any person who has enmity against you, huwa al-abtar, they are cut off. Their legacy is cut off. They are saying, you? No. There. Scholars have mentioned that what this implies, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to say in this verse is, their legacy is going to be cut off. The chain is not going to keep on going. But yours is. Okay? So for example, I'll give you an example. So for example, someone says to someone, I didn't drink that water. What does that mean? Someone else drank that water. It implies that someone else drank that water. So inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar means, verily your enemies, they're the people who are cut off. Not you. You're not cut off. I will keep your name till the day of judgment. These people, As ibn Wa'il, Abu Lahab, and those people who have enmity against you, they are cut off. Their legacy will be finished. It's been 1,433 years. No one even remembers their name. No one even wants to keep their children's name behind Abu Lahab and these people. Okay. And the only reason why we're mentioning their name, we should even be mentioning, Allah SWT didn't mention their name, didn't want to mention their name, okay, is not in a good way, but in a bad way we're remembering the name. Okay. But, O Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, their legacy, their chain, I will cut. But yours, it will remain till the day of judgment. It will remain till the day of judgment. Meaning, وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ O Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we will elevate your status. And your name, okay, will be kept on going. Don't worry. Your name, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and your children, not from the male, because all the male passed away, but from the girls, meaning Hazrat Fatima radiallahu ta'ala, will keep on going. This is why you will see Sayyid everywhere. Sadat. Okay? This is why scholars have mentioned that this also shows the maqam of Sadat, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about the Ahlul Bayt in this surah. That your progeny will keep on going through Fatima radiallahu ta'ala. And the other meaning is that your name, they're saying that no one will your name will be cut off. No. Everyone will be keeping your name. Everyone will be remembering you. This is why, okay, I'll just mention a few stats. So, because I was writing this and I found it really amazing that we're in this. Okay, it's been like 1,433 years since the Hijrah, okay, and then 10 years. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has left this world. But even now, if you study, I was looking at some research papers that I don't know how they've done this research, but we have to believe the research papers that in the world, there are approximately 150 million people, 150 million, who are named Muhammad. Who are named Muhammad, sallallahu, behind Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Just in England, there are approximately 7,000 boys who are named Muhammad. So a question does arrive that when you look at news and when you look at these stats in newspaper and on website, it says Oliver. Oliver is the most highest person named. He's got 6,239 people have named behind Oliver. And Muhammad actually comes at 3,000. But the true answer is that Muhammad is 7,000, not 3,000. Why? Because those people who do research, they take, you know, there's about 14 different variations of Muhammad. M-U-H, M-O-H, M-U-H-A, M-M-A-D, M-A-M-A-D. We know that Muhammad, all these Muhammads are one. But these people, they take it separate because of stats. But they say, if you take all these Muhammad, all the different variation, then his name will come out 7,000. And Oliver's name will come 6,000. So even in England, okay, those people who are saying abtar to Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we can say that he's not abtar. Even now, for the last, I don't know how many years, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's name is at the top. Is at the top in terms of being named after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I was just doing some research behind the name of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then I will conclude. I will share it, okay, so that if anyone finds it interesting, okay. So this is regarding the name, okay. In terms of Durood Sharif, which a person, okay, reads, how many million? Okay, there's about 1.9 billion Muslims. Okay, every day people are reading Durood Sharif, and we don't know how many Durood Sharif are going to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We don't know. Just in England, just in Bali, I was talking to one person. He says that I was asking him that there are a few people who sends him Durood Sharif. How many Durood Sharif do you get? That I've read Durood Sharif 100 times. He said, in a week I get 500,000. This is just one person, and a few people send him Durood Sharif. 500,000. There's a person in Leicester, I was asking him, because people send him Durood Sharif as well. So what they do is they read Durood Sharif and they send, Alhamdulillah, today I was able to read 1,000 Durood Sharif. And this person counts. Now, on an average, how many Durood Sharif comes to you? He said, every week, average, 11 million. Just one person. Okay, and he's got a few groups who sends him Durood Sharif. 11 million per week, average, I get Durood Sharif. Could you imagine how much Durood Sharif, okay? Billions and billions, in billions, Durood Sharif will be read upon Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In Durood Sharif, how many times does the word Muhammad comes? 4 times. How many times? So every time a person is reading Durood Sharif, he is reading, he is mentioning his name, Muhammad, 4 times in Durood Sharif. They were saying, Abtar, they were saying, Abtar, we're going to cut you off. This is going to cut off. And we're 1,433 years, and alhamdulillah, millions and millions and millions of Durood Sharif are going to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is why it comes in one narration that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have made Musa alayhi salatu wa sallam kalimullah, you have made Ibrahim alayhi salam khalil, you have given all these different qualities. What's my, what is there for me? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, oh Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, illa dhukirta ma'i. That whenever my name will be mentioned, your name will be mentioned after it. This is for you. This is for you. This is why when a person gives azan, in an azan, okay, how many times does the word Muhammad come? 2 times. Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. So from the time when the first azan is being given in the island somewhere in Fiji, okay, because so, someone has written a whole report and a whole article on this, okay, there is not a moment, there is not a moment in this world where from the time of, from the island of Fiji somewhere, okay, azan is given, and every town is given azan, azan, azan. It reaches to the western coast somewhere in America, okay, and then it starts. There is not a moment in this world where the azan is not given, where the Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's name is not being mentioned. And Muhammad is the only name which is not only recited, which is not only mentioned, but it is said in a loud voice. Because in an azan, you are told to read azan in a loud voice. There is no other name which you have to say in a loud voice except for Muhammad. Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. So just in England, for example, in England there's about 2,000 masajid. In India there's about 300,000. In the world, according to the a research which was done by Dubai, I don't know, Deloitte, and then another research done by Dubai economic researchers. They were saying that in this world, there's about 3.6 million masjids. 3.6 million masajid. There'll be more, because these are just masajid which are registered. You'll have so many. But let's take there, 3.6 million masajid. In 3.6 million masajid, if you're going to give azan, one azan, okay, and you're going to say the name of Muhammad in the azan 2 times, that means in Fajr, okay, in the time of dawn, you will have already mentioned the name of Muhammad 7.2 million times. Then in Asr, then in Zuhr, then in Asr, then in Maghrib, then in Isha loudly. They were saying, Abtar, this is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying. Then, no, I will not cut your name. Your name will carry on. In Salah, which we read, the last, what do we read? Durood Sharif. In Durood Sharif, how many times does the name of Muhammad comes? 4 times. Okay, what's the population of this world in terms of Muslims? It's about 1.9 billion. Okay? How many people from 1.9 billion will be reading Salah? I'm not even talking about 1.9 billion. Let's take the lowest denominator, lowest, which no one could disagree on. And inshallah, we'll finish. It's 5, let's say 5%. 5% of 1.9 billion people read Salah. Okay, the lowest denominator we're going at. And in Salah, in Zuhr, if you read Sunnah, in Fajr, you read Sunnah, you read Faraz. In Zuhr, you read your 4 rakat Sunnah, your 4 rakat Faraz, then 2 rakats. Okay? How many times? So I was doing some little bit of research that how many times with the name of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will come. So in Fajr Sunnah, the whole world, that 5%, 5% of 1.9 billion is 90 million. So let's say 90 million people are there reading Salah in the world. In Fajr, okay, 90 million people read their Salah and they will read Durood Sharif and they will mention the name of Muhammad 4 times, okay, in 2 rakat Sunnah and in 2 rakat Faraz. That will come to 360 million. In Zuhr, okay, it will come to 1.8 billion. In Asr, okay, so in 90 million people reading Asr, they will have read Muhammad 4 times. It will come to 360 million. In Maghrib, 1 billion and 80 million. In Isha, again, 1.8 billion. This is how many times. If you count all that, just in one day, 5,400,000,000 times. 5,400,000,000 times. So that's 54 plus 8 zeros. That's how many times the name of Muhammad is being taken just in Salah. Just in Salah. We're not even going further. These are just basic. So basically his name is being taken not 100,000, not a million, billions of time in one day, in one day, in one day. This is my Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying that إِنَّ شَانِئَكَ هُوَ الْأَبَتَرُ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, your legacy, your name will be cut off now. Your enemies, their name, their legacy, they will be cut off. Your name, your legacy will remain. And today, alhamdulillah, we are taking his name after 1,433 years of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We are saying Muhammad. And there is not a single person saying his name, their name, who was against Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this was a brief commentary on Surah Al-Asr, the Surah Al-Kawthar. So next time when we read Surah Al-Kawthar, have this in mind. إِنَّا أَعْطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرِ فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ إِنَّ شَانِئَكَ هُوَ الْأَبْتَرِ. Now what can we learn from this? What can we learn? We can learn that the maqam, the first thing we can learn is the status of Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The status of Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The second thing we can learn from this surah is the importance of salah. Strengthen your salah and do shukr through your salah. One of the other things which we can learn, there are so many things, I'm just going through. The other things which we can learn from the surah is, this is amazing, which one scholar mentioned, that this surah also teaches us how to console someone. How to console someone. The Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't start with إِنَّ شَانِئَكَ هُوَ الْأَبْتَرُ, meaning talking about them first and then the goodness. Whenever you console someone, whenever someone is in a problem, whenever there's someone sick, always start with positive. Positive. This is why even when you're going to meet a sick person, what's a dua? لَا بَأْسَ طَهُورٌ إِنْشَاء اللَّهِ. Positive. Be positive. Because everything is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You go there and he says, I'm in stage 4 cancer. Don't think, oh, inna lillah. You're not going to get cured. No, no. You are not the one who is going to cure him. So why worrying about what doctors are saying? Allah is a cure. Have hope in him. Even if it's stage 4. I know stage 4 people, cancer. Okay, where doctors had said no, and alhamdulillah, they are living now. They are cured. And when I speak to them, it was only through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So always be positive. When we're going somewhere, okay, don't start with negative. Okay? So this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showing us the way of consoling, that be positive. Okay? And then talk about, look, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he was positive, he could have just said, Inna atinaka al-kawthar fasalli rabbika wanhar, that's it. Inna shani'aka was the problem. He also talked about the problem. Inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar. So, if there is something wrong, if there is a problem, if there is, for example, there is a problem, someone comes up to you, that this person is bullying me, don't be all positive. Talk about that problem as well. What are you going to do with that problem? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Prophet, what am I going to do with your problem? Inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar. I'm going to cut them off. Meaning their legacy, everything will be cut off. So this is something else which we can learn. The other thing which we can learn from this surah is always be, you know, this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never mentions about his son passing away. You see? It's all positive. For Nabi, إِنَّا عَطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرِ. We have given you Kawthar. I'm giving you Kauthar, positive. That in life, always be positive. Always be, don't look at negative. Because if you keep on looking at negative, okay, you will breed negativity inside you. In every circumstance, in everything, okay, look at positive. Okay, nowadays people spend like 90% in problems and 10% solution. No. Spend 10% talking about the problems, 80%, 90% on solutions. Okay? Talk more of the positive. If you are positive, you will gain positivity. If you have negative, you will... I'll just mention something, okay? In every brain, everyone in here, and who are listening in the world, we have something called RAC, Reticular Activating System, RAC. What is that, Reticular Activating System? Now, for example, if I talk about Ferrari here, Ferrari, okay? I have activated everyone's RAC. What does that mean? You will go outside, you will go, and you will see a Ferrari there. You will see a Ferrari. And then you will be saying, you know what, that Maulana, he's like the biggest buzruk ever, man. I saw a Ferrari today. And he was talking about Ferrari in the masjid. There's nothing buzruk. Meaning what happened there was when I spoke about Ferrari, your subconscious mind, okay, I activated that subconscious mind. Now when you go outside, you don't have to do that job. Your subconscious mind will be looking for Ferraris. And then you will look at Ferrari. Every other day you saw that Ferrari. But your subconscious mind just ignored it. But now it's gone activated. Now, you see, when your mind is negative, when you're outside, when you're talking to people, what is your mind going to take? You're not even telling your mind. Subconsciously, what will your mind take in if you're negative? What? Negativity. Subconsciously, you don't even have to tell your brain that, look, don't take negative. No. For your mind to take in positivity, you have to be positive. Then your RAC will activate and you will take positive. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, be positive. You will. So this is something. The other thing which, there's so many things. One last thing I will mention, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is good as well. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Prophet Inna atinaka al-kawthar, we have given you kawthar. And he could have said, Inna atinaka al-kawthar, inna shaniyaka al-kawthar. But in the middle, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave some orders, gave some advice. This is what you should do. Okay? This also teaches us that not everyone. When you go to console someone, when you're a sick person, okay, this is not everyone's job, that you console someone. You know what you should be doing? You should be doing that, you should be doing this. No, this is not everyone's job. Okay? Those who are high authority, who are pious, who are leaders, when you go and meet someone, okay, then you should give some advice. Then you know what? I think you should do this. This will help you. This will help you. If you are in that hierarchy, okay, then give some advice. Because at that time, the heart is so soft that people will take that advice. Okay. So, but this is not everyone. Because everyone will start giving advice, and that person will become the other person. The other thing which you can learn is Allah's mind is consoling. Okay, consoling. Because this surah is consoling. And it's the shortest surah. The shortest surah, yet the most comprehensive. And it's about consoling. What does this also teach us? That when you go to console someone, okay, go for taziyah somewhere, don't be too long. Don't be too long there. Short, and then come back. This is one of the etiquettes of taziyah. Don't just stay there for hours and end, okay, and you're just there. No. Taziyah is, you go there, whatever you want to read, okay, and then you come out. And there are so many other things which we can learn. I've listed here, but I will not go through. But this is what, Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar, fasalli li rabbika wanhar, inna shani'aka wa la'ba tarmin. Many scholars have mentioned that so many, for example, Maulana Bilal Sab, who's the Khalifa of Sheikh Zakaria rahmatullahi alayh. Actually, Maulana Bilal Sab from Bari, he does bayan now. So after this speech, if you go on YouTube and if you write Tafsir Rahimi, he does a bayan. Okay? Because I'll go home and I'll be listening to him as Maulana Bilal Sab. I met this person outside and he said, Maulana, every Thursday my schedule is set. So I said, what is your schedule? He said, after Isha, I listen to your Tafsir. Then after your Tafsir finishes, then I listen to Maulana Bilal Sab. So Maulana Bilal Sab, He's a khalifa of Sheikh Zakaria rahmatullahi alayhi, mashallah. Muttaqi person. You know, muttaqi person, they are such that they say one word, one sentence. Because I remember so many years ago, I once met Sa'in's Bayan in Darul Ilm. Darul Ilm, when they had the old masjid. He was there doing the Bayan, and I was there, Sa'. And he said that people, they say Medina, Medina. You shouldn't be saying Medina. Medina Munawwara, Medina Sharif, have respect. So from that day, I've been saying Medina Sharif. I don't say Medina. Medina Munawwara, Medina. So he, that's so many years, I don't know, 10, 20 years ago he said that. So these pious people, they say sometimes something in their bayan, in their majlis, one sentence, and it changes your... So mashallah, Imam Bilal Sahib, he'll be doing bayan now. You can listen to his bayan. So one thing he mentioned in his bayan, and again, these are just wazifas, which are experienced by scholars. That if they do this, then it helps them. He was saying that people are talking about debt and then financial problems. They've got problems. Then one wazifa, he said in his bayan, I give to people, and I have seen, he said in his bayan, I have seen that those, whoever I've given this wazifa to, is worked on them. So I will share that wazifa. He says that whenever you get your income, whether it's your cash, recite Durood Sharif once and Surah Al-Kawthar 7 times. And then Durood Sharif once again and blow on your income. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give barakah in that income. And you will find prosperity. You will find wealth coming to you in abundance because of the barakah of Surah Al-Kawthar. So Durood Sharif, Surah Al-Kawthar 7 times and Durood Sharif again, and then blow. And then he was saying that nowadays people don't even carry cash. Then how are they going to blow on cash? Then he said, you can blow on your card as well. Blow on the card. But this is him, Bilal Sahib. He's big buzruk, so he can say all this. So he was saying that whoever I've given this wazifa to, they've come and then said, Alhamdulillah. Problem in terms of the financial problems. Because of the barakah of Surah Al-Kawthar, Inna atainaka al-Kawthar, we have given you abundance. Fasalli li rabbika wanhar, inna shani'aka wal abtar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala firstly give me the tawfiq, and then the rest of us. I apologize for those who are sat here. I've taken so much time of you. But the shortest surah, but the most comprehensive, and I still feel that I've not done justice on this surah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to recite Durood Sharif abundantly upon Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد سبحان الله وبحمده سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك